All right, before we start, just a few disclaimers. If I stand up here and start panting, breathing heavily, it's not what you think. I'm pregnant. Yay! So I need to like chill out sometimes. My baby seems to think my lungs don't matter and is like trying to squeeze in every direction. Also, my mother doesn't know I'm pregnant yet, so please don't be the jerk that blows up my spot on social media. I'm just kidding, she knows. I actually don't know if she knows. I sent her like a screenshot of my ultrasound and then it was like red and then she didn't reply. Like she scene zoned me on like my baby announcement. So I'm like, I don't know, maybe she didn't have her glasses on. She thought it was a meme. Or she's just cold-hearted. I don't know. This is my mother. This is the same person that told Mother Teresa that she needed to moisturize. True story. Yeah. Okay. Now we can start. All right, guys. Hello. I wanted to start today by telling you a little bit about a visionary leader that I recognized early on in my life. His name is Dante Ramirez, and I have met him twice. Once when I was 5 years old, and the second time in 2016, both times in San Francisco, where Dante had relocated to from Manila in the 1980s, not for political reasons. I know you thought that, but because he was young and gay and fabulous and needed to spread his wings in a way that Manila couldn't accommodate at the time. Now, to paint a picture for you, the fashion scene in the Philippines in the era that Dante was a designer in was a world in which models were straight up mestiza, like you were fair-skinned, more often than not, had a last name with a little bit of cachet, anak ng mayaman, child of a socialite. And Dante didn't really fit into this picture. He didn't find inspiration in that sort of a scene. He found inspiration in far different places. And in the case of my mother, he found her in a hospital elevator. Because my mom, like so many other Filipinas, was a young med tech student in Manila. This was late 1974. And the elevator doors opened one day. Dante saw her, and he was like, I need her. She is what I need to fulfill my vision. She had a look that he had been searching for. And so right then and there, he asked her to be a model. Now, my mother had never considered herself model-less. She had never considered herself beautiful. She always felt awkward and gangly, tall, lanky, one of the boys, maybe. And so she had a lot of trepidation and fear, but with enough cajoling, she warmed up to the idea and she bought into Dante's vision and said yes and became one of his muses. Now, Dante had a gaggle of muses, and they were all sort of like my mother in the sense that they didn't really fit into the picture of what it meant to be, again, quote unquote, beautiful in the eyes of the Philippines at the time. But they all had large personalities. They were kind of crazy women, like gregarious, precocious. They fit a look that he was looking for, but Dante was a creative genius. It was not enough to just look the part. He wanted to create worlds around them. He wanted to make characters out of them. And what do you do when you create a character? You give them a name. And so he gave them names. Starting with my mother, who was born Josephine, perfectly respectable name by any means, but no, Dante then dubbed her, and she was forever more known as Electrica. Electrica, what? And I thought, I was like, oh, maybe you were electrifying. You had a big brain. She's like, no, he said I looked like an electric pole. I was like tall and thin. Like, okay. So, I mean, you know, we're Filipinos. We all have crazy titas, right? Like, you know, maybe you have a crazy tita Susan and you have a crazy tita Ching, a tita Malu, tita Baby. Yeah? My crazy titas were tita Luningning, tita Dayang Dayang, tita Dewata, tita Dardanella, tita Venushka, tita Drama Putra. It sounds like a bad word. It's not, I promise you. Tita Zipoteca, spelled with an X. Yo. And so they had all these weird names, and to a certain degree, they're kind of weird looking, right? But they knew what they were getting into because Dante had sold them the vision. He saw everything so clearly. And while the rest of the fashion industry in the Philippines looked over at them and they're like, y'all are crazy, he didn't skip a beat. He knew that he wanted to make this group of models the first Filipina supermodels in the world that would travel the entire globe and represent our country on that level. His vision became a reality. And so if there's anything that you can glean from this, it's that I was born into a world where it was okay to be a little loco. It was okay to be wild and whimsical and wacky as long as you saw it for yourself and it was clear to you. You could go out and pursue that mission and vision. Also, maybe you will glean that my foray into fashion was a little bit set right from the beginning. And though throughout the years I would develop a love-hate relationship with fashion and modeling, it's a whole other story, a different talk altogether. at the beginning, it came really easily, and it was like an opportunity that was right there that I was like, heck yeah, let's do this. I was 5 years old. I was 5 years old the first time I got a modeling gig, and I got that paycheck, and I was like, yes, ballin'. And I went out, and I bought myself a pink BMX bike, and I was like, ooh, I like how this feels. And so I kept doing it. First fashion show, age 8. First commercial, age 15. First time I got a paycheck big enough to turn to my little brother, who was then 7 years old at the time, and say, Albert, you can pick any city in the entire world, and Ate is going to bring you there. He chose Hawaii, thank God. I was 15. First magazine cover, same year. All of this without wanting it, without trying. Even the things that I really, truly did want. I'm a teenager in the late 1990s. Being an MTV VJ is like up there on the bucket list. That's like the most coveted thing. That's the dream. I got that too without trying. I was a script writer, pinch hitting for an event host that didn't show up to that day. Their loss. MTV was in the audience, liked what they saw. Before you knew it, I was on a flight to Singapore to sign a contract. I was 19 years old, and I spent the next 6 years of my life with them, and boy, what a journey that was. I was hanging out with the who's who of the early 2000s. What's up, Ja Rule? Shout out, Mandy Moore. And it was dope, you know? I really felt like this was a position and a job and something that was created exactly for me. This was my destiny. I was supposed to be here. And my manager brainwashed me, and he put this into my head. He's like, you always have to be at the right place at the right time with the right attitude. And I believe that that had happened for me. But I also knew that I couldn't rest on my laurels, that I was in a comfortable place and that I was hashtag blessed and that I couldn't take that for granted. And so every time I showed up at work, I made sure that I was in some way elevating my game, that I was showing up punctual, professional, polite, pleasant to work with. And I think it served me well. And so those things I carried with me no matter where I went afterwards, no matter where my journey took me. And so, you know, I go through that entire phase of my life. Then I start to realize that I'm now finding myself in front of the camera for other reasons, more often than not just to be in front of the camera. And it didn't feel right, didn't feel good. I didn't have a message. And so I backed away and leaned back into my first true love, which is writing and producing. Went back to Manila, started a creative agency and a production company, and changed the focus and the management of one, because I had always only been responsible for me in my career, to now managing a group of extremely creative, visionary young people that were excitable and charged and full of energy. Was I scared? Nah. It was a new sense of responsibility, sure, but because, again, my vision was so clear, this is what we need to do to elevate the urban culture landscape in the Philippines. I was sold. They were sold. They bought into my vision, much like the girls bought into Dante's vision all those years ago. And we went out, and we conquered that. And we did that for Manila. And it felt good. And so after that, I hopped around a little bit. I did a morning radio show, which was fun. Published a book with my girl Vicky. Had never done that before. That was fun too. Then I asked around and tried to see what other opportunities were out there, and I was asked to come on board as creative director for an e-commerce startup. So all of these things pretty disjointed, right? But I felt calm, collected, in control, confident, because it was like, it felt like a natural progression. It was a leap, but it was kind of a manageable leap. I wasn't gonna fall on my ass and hurt myself. It was like, okay, this is something I can do. Until I got the phone call. And this phone call very simply was a statement of a fact. Sarah, we are considering you to be the editor-in-chief of Metro Magazine. Metro Magazine, editor-in-chief? I have not had a lick of magazine publishing experience in my entire life, and you're trying to fast forward and have me skip all those steps and bring me up to top dog right away. Metro Magazine, the flagship lifestyle title under ABS-CBN Publishing. Metro Magazine, all the Filipino celebrities are on our cover, and you want me to take charge of that? You have to understand, my love was in writing and telling stories visually. I have so much respect for editors in chief, and all of a sudden, they were asking me to be one of them. You know, I don't know. I felt like maybe they were a little crazy. I was like, dang. It honestly felt like they were like, here are the keys to a spaceship. I don't know if spaceships actually use keys. Don't quote me on that. They're like, here, please lead this expedition to Mars, based like maybe on the fact that I had dressed up as a Martian one Halloween. Like, it felt like that much of a disconnect, that detached from reality. But I said yes, of course I did, because I was scared out of my mind. It took them 6 months to convince me, and I felt so uncomfortable, and that is why I knew I had to do it. Because like I said, up until that point, everything was fluid. Everything came easily, right? And so I knew, in order to grow, this is something that I gotta come on board with. But I really truly thought they were insane. What I didn't realize is that they saw their vision, and they had a plan, and they saw it so clearly. My boss was dope. She recognized a really powerful short play in the sense that hiring me would create a buzz around the title, be like, what? They hired Sarah? Why? You know, get people talking about it. Maybe even change the trajectory of the magazine. That was their new task. They wanted to bring Metro Magazine into a new chapter. It was a power play short term. But then she also recognized that packed in that short term power play, there was a long play involved. And that is what's called potential. She saw that in me and knew that all she needed to do to get from this to this was come up and establish a day by day, a plan in which I would be exposed to different things, gain experience, evolve in my role as a leader. She saw it clearly. All I saw were my fears in neon lights. Because, yo, like, who am I really to stand in front of my team as their boss? They're all industry veterans. Some of them are on their third or fourth magazine titles. They have hustled their way up in this industry, and I am on my first day ever of doing this. Like, I walked into that office on the first day of work and looked into my team's eyes, and all I saw was skepticism, fear. They might as well have been holding up a mirror, because that's exactly how I felt too. I really felt like each and every person had like this thought bubble going, Lord, help us. Lord, I hope this works. Lord, I hope this works. And boy, let me tell you, those first couple of issues, it did not work. No. On the surface, don't get me wrong, it was smooth sailing, it was fine. The issues came out, the magazine looked dope, and that is 100% because my team kept that boat afloat. They did not skip a beat, no matter what was happening on the inside, all the changes, all the fluctuations. But while they were keeping the boat afloat, I was waltzing in going, hi guys, I'm Sarah, nice to meet you. I now want to steer this in a whole new direction. I was saying all these grandiose things while asking them really basic and fundamental questions, like, I'm gonna steer this in a whole new direction, but can somebody please tell me where the steering wheel is? Come on, man, like, how are you supposed to have faith in your captain when your captain obviously does not know Jack? It was rough waters, my friends. And at the beginning, and I'm ashamed to admit this, but it needs to be told, like, there were times where I threw my team members under the bus, held them accountable and responsible for things that I clearly should have been accountable and responsible for. I didn't know. I was flailing. I was figuring things out as I moved along, and so they were the sacrificial lamb. Not a proud moment. Definitely not a great start to being a great leader, not even a decent start to being a half-decent leader. And so this first foray into magazine publishing was chock full of insecurity, because I had all these amazing ideas in my head. I was like, oh my God, it's so dope. We could do this and we could do that. But every time push came to shove and I was in my content director's office and I had to fight for my ideas, I would go completely mute. And I realized that it was simply because I did not feel like I had the experience to back it up. I could not say, come on, hop on my back, I got this, I've done this before, I've been here before, it's gonna be okay. No, it was like, please invest millions of pesos into, I don't know, my gut feeling that it's gonna be dope. Like, yeah, how much is your intuition worth? So, all those moments, I would come out of that office feeling really voiceless and dejected and sit down at my desk and be like, dang, they made a mistake, they hired the wrong person, I'm not supposed to be here. But those words, I am not supposed to be here, they happen twice in your life. Two different situations. Like, the first, like, when you're really not supposed to be there, like 15 years old and snuck into a 21 and over club on your cousin's fake ID. Like, your ass is not supposed to be there. Get out of here, right? And the second time is entirely fueled by insecurity, self-doubt, and fear. And when that happens to you, and if you ever find yourself in a situation like that, I challenge you to change the narrative. There's going to be a little naysayer in your head saying, you can't do this. They hired the wrong person. You're not supposed to be here. You got to come right back at that with affirmations and be like, no, you know what? I can. Because I realized that if I kept saying I'm not supposed to be there, in no time I was going to be out. And I needed to prove this to myself, and I needed to prove to the people that believed in me, that got me there, that they did not make a mistake. And so I would have this little battle. I'm not supposed to be here. I'm not supposed to be here. Shut up, Sarah. Yeah, you are. I am supposed to be here. I am supposed to be here in the capacity of editor-in-chief of Metro Magazine. I am supposed to be here, no matter where here was, be it overlooking a sunset in LA with Kendall Jenner, or picking Tommy Hilfiger's brain in Beijing, sitting in a first-class seat on somebody else's dime. But more often than not, this battle, this conversation would happen when I was alone at my desk, nobody around, empty office, wee hours of the morning with the printer's proof spread out in front of me and that red pen in my hand. It was like the devil and the angel. You're not supposed to be here. Yes, I am. And little by little, I had to lean back on what I had already accomplished, even though it was not directly applicable to what I had at hand. Life is like a video game, right? You come in, the first time you play a video game, you head into that level. You've never played it before. You fall into a pit. Oops, lose a life. Get stabbed in the side by a spike. Oops, lose a life. But then you come back around and play that level again. You know the pit's there. You know the spike is there. And the more you play it, the more you fall, and the more you get back up again, the more versed you become, the more confident you become. Because with experience, that is where confidence flourishes. And so I had to lean on that. I was like, where was I dope in my life at one point? Let me channel that, Sarah, again, because right now you're not looking too good, sweetheart. And so I remembered, I had always been good at recognizing talent and being like, okay, I'm going to create an environment for this talent to flourish. I'd always been dope at understanding a person's individual why and harnessing that towards the bigger picture, really developing the people in my team for their personal growth that would always, always come back to the company. And so I did things like give this person mad creative freedom, like, go ahead, do you. You don't even need to check back with me, just trust. This person, control, tighten the reins, pull it in, give them structure, force them to ask themselves questions because I knew that they were at a junction in their life that they needed to make a big decision. And I had to do the same for myself. I knew I sucked at going out to parties and getting glammed up. I can never remember anybody's names. But I knew I was dope at writing. So I was like, let me do that. And so I would sit there and I would interview these celebrities for cover stories. I mean, you know, these the Philippines has like this many celebrities, right? And you know all of their stories. Like, they've been on covers before. You know who they've dated. You know the movies they've been in. So it was my challenge to try and find a new story. And more often than not, I would sit with these celebrities and it would turn into like a mini life coaching session. And the artista would walk away feeling empowered. And I would go, oh, I did that. Maybe the difference I'm supposed to make is a different kind of difference. And that gave me wind beneath my wings, should we say. And so I started doing more of that. Little things that maybe my public or my readers would never notice. Maybe even my team didn't notice. But it was little things like reeling in the use of Photoshop so that I could return fashion and beauty to a world that was raw and real and accurately representative of our reader. You know, a place of empowerment and inspiration versus insecurity. The Metro body issue, for example, this happened every year. It was an annual issue, and I had perused it for many years. And it was a beautiful documentation of chiseled abs and toned muscles and zero body fat. It was nice to look at, don't get me wrong, but it wasn't part of my narrative. And so I changed the story to then become a celebration of all different types of bodies. That's what my body issue was. And so it started to feel all right. It started to feel good. I started to sit up a little more straight when we went to the top floor of ABS-CBN to our big boss's boardroom. Because you have to understand, in the galaxy of ABS-CBN, there is so much going on. I mean, TFCU alone, like, you see what's happening. It's an entire map, and Metro sat on the continent of publishing, which lived somewhere over here. But because I had leaned into my personal why, I knew what I was uniquely capable of bringing to the table, and I could feel good about putting Metro on the map. So I eventually left Metro Magazine as its editor-in-chief and transferred into the role of editor-at-large because I moved here to New York City last year to be with my husband. And I only have two regrets. One is that I didn't get to stay long enough to really see my vision through. And two, it's that I had to look back. I had to leave there to be able to recognize everything that I just told you today. Because hindsight is 20/20. And so I would like to leave you with three things today that I have learned in hindsight. Hopefully they can help you too. Number one, you'll find yourself in two situations in life, one in which you are comfortable and the other in which you are uncomfortable. In both scenarios, I urge you to be in a place where you can hold yourself accountable for creating balance and harmony. If you are comfortable, generate enough kindness to extend to the people around you that are not as comfortable as you. Now, this can be translated in so many different contexts, but I think you catch my drift. Now, if you're uncomfortable, take that same kindness and feed it back into yourself. Because discomfort means that this is a growing season for you, and you're going to need all of the nurturing and self-care that you can muster. And in this case, affirmations help. I am supposed to be here. I am the dopest. I got this. I'm designed for success. I am enough. Number two, leadership does not have to be large, nor does it have to be loud. In terms of size, you could be trying to take charge of an entire congregation, a battalion, 400,000 people, or you could be trying to take charge of just you and your life and your inner demons, right? In both, use the formula. Figure out your short play. Do whatever you need to do, that firework, that instant bang that gets the momentum going, that fuels you. But before you start that journey, before you get that bang, you gotta figure out where you're going, right? Figure out where the journey is going to take you. And then when you have those two, you figure out your day-to-day. Because really quick, what is the difference between having a vision and being considered a visionary? It's execution. To paraphrase Thoreau, go ahead. You've painted all these castles in the air. It's all right. Leave them there. Now go build foundations under them. Execute. Commit to your vision. You've got to believe and make it real for other people to see. And in terms of volume, leadership, not always having to be loud. I mean, like, Romeo knows this. I freeze easily. Like, my phone rings and I freak out. Like, I get anxiety. I don't like scenarios in which there's confrontation. I cringe at conflict. And I know that the stereotypical role of a leader, like, you need to be calm. You got to take charge. You got to be vocal. I'm really none of those, but I've never let that stop me from being a leader. Because you got to remember, if you're anything like me, that silent orchestra conductor is as much in control of their ward as a loud drill sergeant is. And that's because that's based on trust and relationships and getting to that point together. Third, discover your personal why. Why, W-H-Y, not letter Y. But that why you find with the letter X. And what is this? This is your cross section. This is what I like to call your plot, your address where only you live. And the reason why only you live there is because nobody else in this world has gone through the exact same things in the exact same order that you have to bring you to where you are today. And so you got to take all of that. You got to harness all of the good, the bad. It's who you are, who you were born to, where you were born, when you were born, who you were raised by. Your childhood loves, your losses, your traumas, who you know, who you thought you knew. For me, it's being born in Hong Kong. It's having a European father and an Asian mother. It's traveling the world. It was my experience at MTV. It was hip hop. It was fashion. It's my role as a mother and wife. It's my love for the Philippines and my deepest desire to elevate us and represent us really well on a global level. That's me right here. What about you? Where are you at? Because I guarantee you, and this is a promise that I will make to you, if you find your plot, your cross section right here, X marks the spot, and right there, there is a treasure chest. And if you open that treasure chest in there, there is a personalized, customized roadmap to your visionary leadership. Maraming salamat.